Shalom, old friends. Shalom, new people. Shalom, dyed-in-the-wool animal activists, liberators. Shalom, good people. Someone said, maybe there are people here because they had a dog at home who they rescued from the street. Maybe they're here because they decided not to buy a fur coat or a leather jacket. Maybe they're here because a relative became ill and was told to go vegan. Or maybe they're here just because they care. And the important thing is you're here. Everybody here, by joining this march, you join a movement, not just a march, but a movement to create a more understanding world in which tyranny, injustice, and supremacy will not be accepted anymore. We want to create a world in which we define ourselves in a far broader way than as a human being, as a woman, as a man, as this religion or that religion. We want to define ourselves saying, we are all animals. And all animals matter. The vegan movement, as you know, stands for justice. It stands for fairness. It stands for nonviolence, and it stands for an end to prejudice in every ugly form. We recognize respect for others who, regardless of the way they look, share exactly the same feelings with human beings, like love and joy and grief and pain. We understand that. We don't want animals in cages, in shackles, in chains. We want them to live the life they were meant to live. A march like this is a powerful thing. It isn't just walking, it's a message. And all over the world, marches have begun. In France, people marched to close the slaughterhouses, and already three are closed. In Spain, people have been marching to ban the bullfight, and already 100 towns have banned the bullfight. People marched years ago to end fox hunting, the national sport, I'm ashamed to say, of Britain. And now no one is allowed to hunt foxes. We are marching, we are winning, and this is a very important, pivotal time. Animal circuses are closing down all over the world. Car companies are creating vegan leather interiors. Supermarkets are full of a wealth of wonderful vegan foods. And human organs on a chip are replacing animal tests. Thank God for technology. The world is changing because of technology. The world is changing because people are waking up. And the world is changing because of activism. That is everything. I live in Washington, D.C. There are a lot of things you could say about Washington, D.C. But it's not the only thing is the home of the White House. It's also the home of a college for deaf people called Gallaudet. And the students at Gallaudet some years ago wanted a deaf president. But the board of directors said, no, you're getting a hearing, President. And the students went on strike, and they rioted, and they boycotted, and they protested, and they marched. And then they were given a deaf president. The head of the student union wrote this. He said, "When slaves in America wanted their freedom, whites weren't ready. But slaves were ready. When women wanted the vote, men were not ready, but women were ready. And when deaf students wanted a deaf president, the university was not ready, but the students were ready." And today, what are we going to say? A lot of people aren't ready for animal rights, but the animals are ready. Today marks a time when the rest of the world will know that we are ready to get those rights for them, and that will mean a lot of action on our part. Human beings once only thought that they knew how to use tools, but the crow and the octopus and the monkey proved they were wrong. Human beings once only thought they were capable of using language, but the prairie dog and the hen and the rhinoceros proved them wrong. And human beings once only thought that they experienced feelings, emotions, empathy, sympathy, and altruism. But bats bring food to injured bats. Even ants bring food to injured ants. A little fish will hold another fish up to the surface when they can't breathe. When humans all thought that the earth was flat, a little bird showed them it wasn't. An albatross flew all around the globe and knew that the globe was round before human beings did. A little sparrow doesn't have a GPS or a map that we need, but he can go 5,000 miles every year and come back to the same little village, the same little house, every single time. Before human beings dared to go to sea, ants were building boats out of leaves and making bridges with their bodies. All animals possess impressive intelligence, all of them. But as Jeremy Bentham wrote, and we know, the question is not, can they reason? Nor can they speak, but can they suffer? And suffer they do. Dr. Carl Sagan spoke of how experimenters gave monkeys in cages food only if they would press a button and shock a monkey in an adjoining cage. After hearing the cry of the shocked monkey when they pressed that button, most monkeys chose to starve rather than press the button. One monkey went without food for 11 days, and the monkeys showed it wasn't them that lacked empathy, it was the experimenters. That single one illustration of what's wrong in laboratories tells us we must work hard to close all animal labs down. If someone tells you, well, animals are stupid, you can quote to them Dr. Robin Kemmerer, who wrote, "I can't think of a single scientific study that has demonstrated that animals are stupider than we think. Studies always show the opposite. They show that all animals have extraordinary capacities, and we are at the edge of a wonderful revolution in understanding the sentience of all living beings." So let us loudly say what we know to be true, that all the other animals are not inferior to us in any way. They are like us in every important way. And only the hand of human tyranny denies them rights. As Christina Rossetti wrote, the tiniest living thing that soars on feathered wing or crawls among the long grass out of sight has surely just as good a right to its appointed portion of delight as any human king. Sometimes we know what's obvious to us is not obvious to others, and we must help them understand. I tell you a story about the cowboy, the Lone Ranger, and his sidekick, Tonto. Do you know the Lone Ranger and Tonto?
Yeah.
All right. So one night, they were camping in the desert, and they set up their tent, and they went to sleep. And a few hours later, Tonto woke up the Lone Ranger and said, "What do you see when you look up at the sky?" And the Lone Ranger said, "Well, Tonto, I see millions of stars." And Tonto said, "What else do you see?" And the Lone Ranger thought for a minute, and he said, "Well, looking up tells me there are millions of galaxies and maybe billions of planets. It tells me that Saturn is in Leo. It tells me that it's about 3 o'clock in the morning. And it tells me we're likely to have a beautiful day tomorrow. What does it tell you, Tonto?" And Tonto said, "It tells me that someone has stolen our tent." So what the point of that is to say that even smart people miss obvious facts. They may know facts. They may know all sorts of facts about animals. They may know dog breeds and how long a giraffe's neck is and how fast a cheetah runs and the size of a whale. But they miss the central point, and that is who the animals are, because each animal is a wonderful living being with rights just like us. Every person here, every single person here has opened their heart and their mind, and their job is to open other people's hearts and minds. It's never enough to change yourself. It's not about us, it's about them. And sometimes you may get frustrated, like a stone cutter who is hitting and hitting and hitting at a rock and it doesn't crack. 100 times he hits the rock and it stays in one piece. On the 101st time he hits the rock, it splits in two. It wasn't the last blow that did the damage. It was persistence working away at the problem. So shall we take Mahatma Gandhi's advice to the young boy on the railway station who said, "My eyes have been open, now what shall I do?" And Mahatma Gandhi said to him, "Go now and tell others and change them too." When asked why we don't drink milk or we don't eat meat or we don't wear leather or fur or wool, remember, we can answer back. When you know about the sickening, horrible, painful conditions in which animals live, and a mother cow's baby is taken from her, her beloved baby, the real question is not, why don't I use those things? The question is, how can you? When the composer Philip Glass was told, "Well, it's hard sometimes to find non-leather shoes," his response was, "Yes, but it's far harder for the animals if you don't." Our cause, all of us, is not a tea party. It's not a hobby. It's a revolution. Let us pledge today to leave our comfort zone. There is no glory in being comfortable. Change comes from discomfort zones. Let's pledge today never to be silent, never to cross the road if we see suffering, but to move closer to it and see what we can do to help. To use our voices, to use our consumer power in the marketplace, to show how easy it is to make kind choices in everything, and never ever to abide hatred and bigotry, to be the kind and good people that each of us knows we are. Thank you very much. Good luck. Shalom. Shalom.